So this lady is one related to elder son of Gandhi, and she also had met Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, and she came to see me. So as regarding myself, I have great admiration for Mahatma Gandhiji, and I am a follower of his non-violence principle, and I'm a follower of him. So she's the granddaughter, similar granddaughter of Gandhiji. So she showed me pictures of herself with Mahatma Gandhi. She was actually holding Gandhiji's hands and helping him. So since she has held her hands with Gandhi's hands, I want her to touch my face with her hands. So I just thought that it would be good to introduce her to all of you here. She told me that I am a manifestation of the Buddha.
Thank you.
So the lady asked His Holiness that she should tell her what His Holiness had told the public here. So Professor Samdong Rinpoche,
he will translate, and then I mentioned next September we will organize one meeting. So he already some brief, short brief.
You want to meet?
Yes.
So does she have anything to say to the public? La. Ore. So His Holiness the Dalai Lama.
But would you like me to speak in English? Hindi, okay. Hindi or English? Let me. Well, it is my rare privilege that I have come here to have the
darshan
of Dalai Lama. Our Guru. In this age, if there is anybody who is an incarnation of Lord Buddha, who is working for non-violence and peace in the... Hello. He is the only person, according to me, who is working for the peace and happiness and integration. We are all quarreling among ourselves, but Guruji, I don't like to call him Dalai Lama, which is a commonly used person. For me, he is Guruji, more an incarnation of Lord Buddha, but also of my grandfather. Yes. So, I have come not only to Dalai Lama, but I have come to my grandfather's house. And that is how I feel, that all of you are my relatives. And to see so many of you here in this faraway place is a rare privilege and a blessing for me. It is this blessing of Guruji which will help me survive and will guide me through my life. and I'm deeply grateful for this privilege. Sir, I'm deeply grateful to you for giving me. Please let me touch your feet.
Gandhi, Samo, Pu Gembe Pu, Bomo.
I
know a few of the relatives of Gandhiji, and with regard to this, so she is the granddaughter of Gandhiji and has lived with Gandhiji, and so, as I said before, and so in this 20th century, when the Indian freedom struggle was going on, Gandhiji used the non-violent principle, non-violence, as the means for. And so this is not something that Gandhiji innovated, but it is a tradition that India already had by that time for thousands of years. And so of many different religions, traditions living together in harmoniously was there already in India. And so in this world, perhaps I can say all the religious traditions of the world are in India. It is only in India that this is the case and not other countries. And so all the major religious traditions of the world living side by side is only something that is seen in India. And so this thousands of year old tradition of Tibet, of India for nonviolence and religious harmony is something which we need to revive this in for the new generations. I have been telling this, and so as a follower of Gandhi, I do my best. And so this lady who is in the bloodline of Gandhiji, I told her that she should dedicate herself for this as well. So I'm very happy to have met her. Relying on the I think we are on page 212 in the new edition and page 178 in the old version of the blue book, The Pearl of Garland. Relying on the method for happiness in future life. This is from the southern lineage. And so this has two sections, taking refuge, the gateway to the teaching, meditating on karma and its effects, the source of all goodness and happiness. With regard to taking refuge, the actual topic, there are two, the actual topic and the precepts. The guide to the Bodhisattva way of life says, just as the night swathed in darkness and clouds is momentarily illuminated by a flash of lightning, likewise by the Buddha's power. On rare occasions, the thought to produce their merit occasionally arises, thereby comprehends that virtue remains feeble, while powerful sins are not the least exhausted, not in the least exhausted. Based on the following three, fear of misdeeds and results, faith in good qualities, compassion for beings like yourself, reflect. Compared to my past sins, which are like a great ocean, my virtue is like a few drops of water picked up by the tip of a blade of kusha grass. It is extremely feeble. Furthermore, in this life, having become used to the title and appearance of a Dharma practitioner, I have misled others. For when I compare my thoughts and behavior to Buddha's words, the vast majority of them tend to the side of non-virtue. Therefore, since the enemy, the suffering of the lower realms, is sure to reach me within the next 100 years, nothing is more vital than seeking a place of refuge for protection from them. What is suitable? What is a suitable refuge? The 70 stanzas on refuge says, the Buddha's Dharma and Sangha are the refuges of those desiring liberation. If it is necessary to take refuge in the three jewels, what is the way to do so? Praise with similes says, your body adorned with the signs is beautiful, ambrosia for the eyes, like a cloudless autumn sky, adorned with clusters of stars. Thinking, here is the Tathagata, whose body color is like refined gold, his body bears the three monastic garments, and is adorned with the major and minor marks. One never tires of looking at it, nor is it ever displeasing to behold. Meditate on it with faith, intense aspiration and joy. As for his verbal qualities, the words issuing from the throat of the Buddha are pleasing sounds, possessing 64 melodious qualities. If all the sentient beings of the three realms of existence were to simultaneously ask him questions, the answer he would give in a single language like Sanskrit would be heard in each being's language and would dispel all their doubts at once. Among his mental qualities, there is a quality of knowledge. With his superior wisdom of omniscience, he is skilled in caring for his followers according to their capacities. Then there is the quality of compassion, since he is unbiased towards those who anoint him with sandalwood paste on one hand and those who would leave him with an cleave him with an axe on the other. His compassion for all beings like a mother's is like a mother's for her only child. As for his quality of activity, since he is beneficent, he will enter the inferno of hell with as much delight as covetous person enters the pleasure ground of the higher realms. Contemplate the ways he works for the welfare of sentient beings. Such qualities are not causeless, nor do they arise from incompatible causes, having ascertained that it is by learning, reflecting upon them and meditating on the guide's dharma. Jewel of scriptures, the scriptures whose main topics are the truths of cessation and the path that one makes manifest within one, the Dharma jewel of realization, the truth, and meditate until you achieve uncontrived faith in the Dharma jewel. As for the Sangha jewel, it consists of Dharma bodhisattvas such as Maitreya, Manjugosha, and Avalokiteshvara, and in listeners, Sangha such as the great Kashyapa, the excellent pair. Thinking, although they have not attained the actual Buddha qualities, they practice the two truths and are companions to realize refuge. with their minds suffused with trust, say, I take refuge in the Buddha's supreme bypass. I pray that they may serve as my guides to freedom from the fears of samsara and the lower realms. I take refuge in the Dharma, the supreme level of exclusion of attachment. I pray that they may serve as the actual refuge, freeing me from the fears of samsara and the lower realms. I take refuge in the Sangha, supreme among assemblies. I pray that they may serve as assistance to freeing myself from the fears of samsara and the lower realms. Recite these formulae as one sequence, as many times as you can, 100 and so forth. And then the precepts of taking refuge. Having taken refuge in the Buddhas, do not entrust yourself to any powerful worldly gods as ultimate refuges. Having taken refuge in the Dharma, give up harming sentient beings. Having taken refuge in the Sangha, do not make true friends of those who do not believe in the three jewels. These are the prescriptive precepts. As for the prescriptive precepts, there are to consider them as the Buddha jewel, an image of a Buddha, Buddha's physical form, even one of interior artistry or material, to view any scripture of four lines or more as the Dharma jewel, and regard as Sangha jewels, even those who show only the outward signs of the ordination. Make them offerings, praise, and serve them. For doing so is the ideal source of all excellence, benefit, and happiness in this life and the next. Meditating on karma and its effects, the source of all goodness and happiness. Although contemplating the difficulty of attaining freedom and fortune, death and impermanence, and the sufferings of the lower realms may lead you to feel that there is a pressing need to practice the Dharma, if you have no idea how to practice it, you will have immoderate desires for food, clothing, and belongings, deeming them necessary conditions for Dharma practice. For their sake, you will perform various misdeeds, thereby spending your entire time involved with the variegated eight worldly concerns. Some sacrifice the three, food, clothing, reputation, and mildly suppress the three physical non-virtues, all the vile, yielding to the remaining seven. Thus they spend their entire time with the white eight worldly concerns and sully their three doors by sins and transgressions. On this basis, after death, white and black karmas will follow like a shadow, and as it says in the jewel garland, all suffering arises from non-virtue, so do all the lower realms. All higher realms arise from virtue, as does happiness in all lives. The law of black and white karma and its effects is said to be infallible. The one who stated it is the Buddha. The king of concentration sutra says the moon and the stars may fall from their places, mountains, cities, and the rest of may collapse. The space elements may even take another form, but you will never speak falsely. Thinking it is. So with regard to idle talk, so His Holiness is on the idle talk on page 217. So we are watching movies and television shows, and also using gadgets to watch entertainment and movie. It's a different case if you are using it for educational purpose, listening to news and so forth. These will be helpful and are needed, but for distraction, it is not good, because you will decline in your study and education. So some of my friends say that when we had very few facilities, of course, during the debate sessions and also during the classes, we would focus on study. But even when we were going around, walking, taking walk, and so forth, and we would still spend our time discussing about what we were studying, the different texts and reasons and so forth. But these days, the monks and those who are engaged in study are actually, during their spare time, they even talk about movies and other stuff. And so we, who are who claim to that they, we are the ones who aspire to aspiring to liberation and omniscience. We should not spend our time idly, and we should become aware that we are being ignorant if you do so. So we should not let ourselves be swayed by ignorance, but practice conscientiousness. And so it says the base, the subject of for idle talk, the base, the subject of devoid, a subject devoid of meaning that does not fall into any of the previous category, three categories is identified as such. With any of the clashes and the motivation that is the desire to say meaningless things, the action is telling pointless stories about kings, ministers, generals, thieves, and so on, repeating the words of the songs and plays out of attachment, and for ardent people undertaking to flatter others. To seek gain, it is complete as soon as the words have been spoken. And then the greed, and next is ill will. In the wrong view. So moreover, the maturation effect of very serious sins is rebirth as hell being, for fairly serious ones as a hungry ghost, and for lesser ones as an animal. The effect similar to the cause for killing is to have a short life. For stealing, it is perverted. For sexual misconduct, it is inability to keep a spouse. For lying, it is criticism. For divisive talk, speech, it is paucity of friends. For cruel speech, it is hearing many unpleasant things said. For idle talk, it is disregard for your words. For greed, it is the unfulfillment of your hopes. For ill will, it is great fear. For wrong view, it is the ignorance regarding excellent views. Think. Moreover, although in the past, for a lack of watchfulness, I committed many sins, I do not recognize as accumulated what I have accumulated. Now, with watchfulness, whenever they are about to occur, I will make sure to apply the antidotes. However, this alone is insufficient. I must strive to accomplish virtues. For that, I must know what they are. The 10 virtues are the reverse of the 10 non-virtues. In particular, to attain an excellent form of life for the achievement of enlightenment, it is absolutely necessary that I be unsullied by these non-virtues, and that I do not acquire new ones. Despite this, in the present life, if I have accumulated innumerable sins, and that is only a fraction of them for in many lives, not only for my sake, but also for the sake of patrons, children, friends, relatives, spouses, circles of servants, regions, and monasteries, and so forth, I have accumulated tons of sins. When I experience the maturation effects, I will not share them with the others. They will fall on me alone. As for karma, whose result is certain to be experienced according to the treasury of knowledge, it is irreversible. Whatsoever I do, it seems I cannot free myself from samsara. Once you have reached the point where you are troubled by this thought, think. Thank goodness our most compassionate and skillful guide gave many teachings, those of certain meaning and those to be interpreted. If the lesser vehicle explains the matter in this way, the definitive meaning is that even the most serious misdeeds, like the 5 sins of immediate retribution, can be neutralized by practicing confession and abstention. A letter to a friend says, a person who, once careless, later becomes conscientious, is a beautiful as cloudless moon, as were Nanda, Angulimala, Jatashutra, Udayana, and so forth. And so the intermediary verse, the wise who wish to use freedom and fortune well on death, lack of time, and lower realms of suffering, reflect them. As for the affairs of this life, they reject attachment to them and aspire to happy results. So we have stopped at page 219, where it says the interchapter verse. Dayomara. Dara. Nirlam. Jamru Jangwa. So now we are switching to the quick path or the swift path. We have come to the topic on cultivating the principle of taking refuge. So if you wish to do this practice slightly more elaborate than what is given in the bare guidance of the blissful path or the easy path, so to whom you take the course of refuge, taking refuge, is that oneself and other sentient beings, you fear the suffering of oneself and other sentient beings in the lower realms, and you fear suffering in samsara in general and the lower realms of existence, and then you see that the three jewels have the power to save you from them. And so these are the two main causes that gives rise to taking refuge in the three jewels. So in Benjen Lobsang Chökyen's reply to Master Tsongkhapa's queries from a pure heart, he has said that the real nature of taking refuge in the three jewels is that first of all that you give in or submit to the you take refuge in the three jewels by seeing the fearful, the terrifying nature of the samsara, and then particularly. And also seeing that the three jewels have the power to save or protect you from them. And so to whom you take refuge in is one who has freed himself from all fears and terrors, terrifying states. And then one who is skillful in liberating others from such fearful states, and who has this impartial compassion towards all sentient beings, and whether and helping or benefiting those, whether they have helped him or not, regardless of that. So such a one is needed for us to take refuge in. So therefore, only the fully enlightened Buddhas are the ones who have such a quality. So if even the powerful gods, the great gods like Rudra and Krishna and so forth, do not have such qualities, then what need is there to say that the hungry ghosts and nagas and local spirits and have such power. So if even by taking refuge in the arhats of the disciple lineage would free you from certain fearful states, then what need is there to mention, says that you'll be saved from fearful states and fear by taking refuge in the Buddha. So So you should know the distinction of the three jewels, and then also the qualities, that excellent qualities of the three jewels. And over and over again, you should take think of taking refuge in them. So the easy path, or the path of bliss, which is the other text that we have covered, says that you imagine nectar flowing from the, your guru deity, who is on your crown. And so from the heart of the deity, guru deity, lama, yidam, three jewels, and darkest darkinis, and also the Dhamma protectors are emanated, filling up the space. And then have a very clear visualization of all of them, your guru is surrounded by all these deities and lamas and so forth. And then you remind yourself of the great qualities of the body, speech, and mind, and then knowledge and qualities and activities of these objects of refuge. And then remind yourself of the sufferings of the lower realms of existence, as explained before, and have a clear idea of them, and then feel fear. And feeling scared and of this, then you make prayer to them, saying that please save me and all sentient beings from samsara in general, and particularly that the terror of the lower realms, of the unfortunate realms right now. So with this intention, you take refuge in the Lama, Yidam, and the three jewels. Say that you are going to, I take refuge in the Lama, Yidam, the meditational deities, and the three jewels. So you may do this practice of taking refuge, reciting such lines by hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of times and so forth. So by knowing the benefits, temporary and the short-term and long-term benefits of taking refuge in the three jewels, and then you should train or practice the precepts of the taking refuge. So with regard to the benefits of taking refuge in the three jewels, you become a Buddha, a Buddhist.
Gawa
So all your negativities that you've collected in the past will be suppled and become supple, and then you'll be able to overcome them completely, and you will be a basis for all kinds of it'll serve as the basis for all kinds of vows. And then you will accrue a great merit, and you will not fall into the lower realms of existence. So some a god who was about to be reborn is a pig, or a pig. By taking refuge in the Buddha, he was saved from this terror of the lower realms of existence, and was reborn in a higher realm, within the God realm. So this is an example of not falling into lower realms of existence by taking refuge. So there are many other things mentioned. And so with regard to the precepts that you keep of taking refuge, there are precepts related to each of the three jewels, and also the common precepts. So even if you may engage in virtuous actions and avoid non-virtuous, if still you feel very weak, you need to do the practice of opposing powers or forces for purifying negativities. So if you have more spare time, you should do this practice as it is found in the Golden Light Sutra more extensively. The text goes through the 10 virtuous actions. So having trained your mind in the paths that shared with the beings of small scope, So whereas in the past you are more interested in fulfilling goals of this life, now if you become more interested prefer to engage in engaging yourself in the Dharma, then that is the measure of having developed this mind of or the attitude of beings of a small scope.
Kasa.
So the full pleasures of this life becomes just something that you consider to be a byproduct, whereas your main intention is to have a higher rebirth in the next life. So although this is experiences of the beings of small scope may be quite difficult to experience for us, but we need to put effort in the practices. Because Jerem Buche says, so in his prayer of Luipa tradition of Jagrasamvara, Jerem Buche has made this prayer. The instruction given by that master, which mentions the meaningfulness and the rarity of finding a precious human life, and how easy it is to disintegrates, and then also the suffering of the lower realms of existence, and then you take refuge, and then follow the precepts of paying heed to the law of causality. And then you have a very firm conviction in them. And may I be able to be on... To catch up with the tip of this path, and so with this we have completed the path of shared with the beings of small capacity, and then next is the beings path of shared with beings of intermediate scope. And so we are on the fifth Dalai Lama's text. Second, the training the mind in the stage of the path common to the middle individual, the lamp for the path states, one who is in the nature of having turned their back to the pleasures of cycling existence and stopped from negative actions, and one who aspires on this personal peace, such a person is known as the a middle individual. So as said here, a small individual aspires for higher status as God or humans, but however do not perceive just this as the object of achievement. Thus those who strive to achieve just the peace and happiness of having liberated from cyclic existence by relying on the means or three precepts are explained as middle individual. Therefore, here, even though it is not the mere peace that is being sought, but in order to achieve knowing all aspects or omniscience before that one must achieve liberation from. Hence, in order to practice or adopt the stages of the path common to the middle individual, having practiced earlier the practices during the period of the small individual without disturbing the order and without confusing the order, and thus not having to suffer the experience of suffering of suffering, and it's just like a person freed from the dungeon and thus achieve special joy. However, the person has no confidence that he will not be imprisoned again. Likewise, even if one achieves the body or a life of a happy migration in the life hereafter due to having purified negative deeds, having committed in the past through the four antidotal powers and not having accumulated them fresh and having practiced the ten virtues. However, due to not having eliminated the afflictive emotions, the thought in the past life fearing the suffering of bad migration will not stay, and hence there is no guarantee that fresh non-virtues will not be accumulated. If accumulated again, you will return to the place of bad migration. Thus, the Bodhisattva Charyavatara states, repeatedly coming, visiting the happy migrations and having continuously enjoyed many pleasures after dying falls into the suffering of bad migration, which is ceaseless and of long duration. So, for example, when tormented by the contact of heat, and then let cool breeze or running stream hit your body, you develop peace or comfort for the time being. However, with the passage of time, the suffering of cold will be produced. Likewise, all contaminated happiness and pleasure are all suffering, and hence temporary pleasures are not reliable. Presently, the two actions and afflictive emotions had made conception take place in this cyclic existence and had thoroughly bound us. With a wish to renounce this and with the intention to abandon when it is practiced, with effort one gets liberated from the bondage. That is the state of peace. And in order to strive just this, there are two: contemplating on the suffering of cyclic existence, explaining the stages of the practice of the path that liberates from it. The first one has two parts in it: reflection through suffering and origin, and reflecting through the 12 dependent originations, 12 links of dependent originations. The first has two parts: suffering as the fault of cyclic existence, and origin as the stage or the process of entering into the cycle of existence. The first is as stated in the sutra: bhikshus, this is true noble, this is true noble suffering, this is true noble origin of suffering. Thus, this teaching of the result, true suffering first, and the cause, the true origin of suffering latter, seems reversing the cause and the result, but how that has the intention of a special purpose is stated in the 400. To this ocean of suffering, there is no end at all. Why you, child, who is sunk here, do not develop fear? The so long as there is mind perceiving the result, suffering as peace, one will So in the Mahayana Uttara Tantra, it states, as a means for undertaking the work of changing the course of the water flow is true path, as this Mahayana Uttara Tantra says, the disease is to be recognized, and the cause of the disease to be eliminated, the state of health is to be achieved, and the medicine is to be taken. Likewise, suffering, cause, stopping it, and similarly, the path should be known, abandoned, achieved, and applied respectively. So if being soaked with water is not recognized as suffering, then the wish to stop that water will not arise. If being free from the moisture is not known as peace, then there will be no wish to construct dam to stop the water. Thus, both in the case of happiness and suffering, the result should be identified, and then the action of adopting and discarding the producers, the cause is extremely of great importance. Having internalized this process well, in order to contemplate on the two suffering first, in the stages of the path, while explaining the general and specific sufferings of cyclic existence individually and relating to them to birth and aging in general, is done from the point of view of greater elaboration. If the meaning in hand is summarized. In the case of the three bad migrations, a standard experience have been meditated during the a small individual. During the path of the small beings, small scope, beings of small scope, someone whose sickness has been highly intensified or aggravated and who is nauseating through drinking wine develops ugliness or disliking by merely seeing the liquor. And as a result, without having to intentionally think on its specificities, like sour or bad taste, it will come like the cutting of flowers side by side, and as a byproduct, wild horse running. Likewise, not specifically meditating on the suffering of birth or bad migration will not become a fault, and with regard to reflecting primarily in relation to the suffering of happy migrations as the actual topic, and meaning there are three human beings and the other two types of migration and meeting, meditating on the common suffering of the six categories. So the first, those that have taken rebirth due to afflicted emotions are subject to very suffering of aging, death, and so forth, and due to totally uncalmed mental state, they finally are not beyond them, not beyond them being subject to death while fatigued physically and mentally by the three poisons. Even though four states of birth have been taught, but primarily from the point of view of womb birth, the epistle to the student states, constricted in an extremely impure, foul-smelling filth, living in an extremely tight or narrow and clouded darkness, the one in the womb having entered in that hell-like state has to bend the whole body and has to suffer great suffering. As stated here, one exists below the stomach and above the large intestine, the mouth facing towards back joints, amidst a smelly unclean substances. From there, during the periods of gradual development from the oval shape to the protrusion or the elongation of the limbs, when the mother takes hot food and drinks, one experiences as if one got into a pit of fire. When she uses cold living with the crevices of ice, when she jumps and runs and so forth, falling into an abyss, you feel like falling into it. So this is blessing the tea. So this is about the suffering of birth. And then next is the suffering of aging. Aging makes the attractive form unattractive. Aging robs splendor and robs power and capacity. Aging robs peace and affronts. Aging nourishes and aging drops radiance.
Dear descendant, suffering of death.
So till here, the suffering of sickness has been completed. And so the next is the suffering of death. The Lalit Vistara states that transference and the time of transference of death, people that are dear to one's heart are forever separated and will not return and will not meet. Just like leaves separating, falling from trees of a river. If one could be free from sickness, then it is worthwhile to undergo such hardships. But in the case of the MERS, even if various means are adopted, the sickness becomes greater. The doctor leaves him. Divination and the bone treatment fails. Relatives and friends surround you and lament. Preparation will be made for cremation and death will be preferred. In one's own case, the retinence declines, mouth dries, lips curl off, nostrils collapse, eye becomes sunken, breath will pant, one will regret negative deeds done in the past, one will separate it from all excellences like relatives, friends, followers, servants, possessions and wealth. One has to even leave one's own body, which one is so highly looked after in the sleeping place. Reflect how one, due to intense attachment and craving, will suffer intensely when going beyond this world. Suffering in relation to enemy. What need is there to talk about the suffering of the apprehension that the ugly enemy will harm one's body, life, fame, aims, even if one has to get together with a real enemy or someone that one is in disharmony in one place or house, you mentally feel very uncomfortable and develop a feeling of darkness. If that one goes to some other direction, you develop joy like dawning. Hence, in relation to this, reflect on the suffering apprehension that one will meet with enemy that one hates. Suffering in relation to relatives and friends. So the suffering pertaining to human beings is something that we can experience. It is not something obscure phenomena. It is not something obscure phenomenon and also not something that needs to be proved. It is what we all experience. And the human rebirth is happened through the positive virtues, positive karmic results. And of course, even if it is arisen through such great causes of karmic positive karmic causes, then even if we are in such a state, such as falling ill and so on, then what should we think about the other realms of the other realms like the lower realms, which are so much more suffering than we human beings? Suffering in relation to desire. In case of the businessmen and farmers, even after hard work, they lose the merchandise, get lost, and the crops get destroyed by hail. In the case of heads and ministers, not being able to control their enemies and take care of their friends. In the case of monastics, not being able to successfully take care of their ethical discipline due to weak antidotes or not being able to succeed in the work of hearing. and thinking due to inferior wisdom and so on, and thus suffer from not finding what one desires through seeking. Likewise, if you examine the whole world, like the powerful becoming weak, the rich becoming poor, and many human beings becoming just one, they are not in their original state and so on. In short, through varied undesired things like hunger, thirst, heat and cold, even this very human life is in the nature of suffering, and this should be contemplated until an experience is developed from the depth of the heart. Even though in the path to enlightenment, the contemplation on eight sufferings and contemplation on six sufferings is taught in general, but while explaining, for the sake of easier engagement, the contemplation on seven sufferings are applied primarily to human beings, and after that, the sufferings of other two happy migrations, the eight suffering, the three sufferings, and the six sufferings are treated in general. Contemplating on the suffering of other two happy migrations, the epistle to the friend states, the color of the body becoming ugly, distasteful, not liking the seed, fading of the flowers, dirt staying on the clothes and developing sweats on the body, which one never had earlier. These are the five omens of death, inviting death and transferences from the high state. As stated, even though the gods in the desire realm did not have sufferings of birth, aching and so forth as human beings do, but when death is close, certainly the retained color of the body declines, does not relish sitting on the comfortable seat. The flower garland becomes old, dirt and stains stay on their clothes and develop sweat on the body, which one never had earlier. These are the five omens of death. Likewise, the light of the body becomes weak, the cleaning water stays, unpleasant sounds come forth from the clothes and ornaments, the eyelash dances, and develops attachment to only one object. These are the five close omens of death. Third, reflecting on the common sufferings of six types are additionally till one is liberated from cyclic existence. Even if one is born as a universal monarch or Brahma, due to merit again, one will become a slave, and this actualizing suffering. Sufferings of this life, like birth, aching, sickness, and death, are actualized suffering. The intensified state of suffering, like the one that is encountered due to contact with salty water when salt is added on a malignant tumor, is suffering of suffering. When tired of going, resting, and this is the suffering of change, from one who got entrapped amidst, has no occasion for warmth, until one is freed from that is pervasive conditioning suffering. Thus, if the whole meaning is summarized, so long we take this contaminated appropriating aggregate, there in alternative that to suffer in relation to the present aggregate and to induce further subsequent sufferings. Appropriation means aspiration and attachment, just as a fire that comes from what is called wood fire, likewise due to desire for future body and attachment to the present body, the aggregate is actualized. Thus the name is given in relation to the cause, likewise a tree that bears fruits is called fruit tree. This actualized aggregate produces aspiration and attachment, and thus the name is designated. Again, it is stated in the letter to the friend that father being son and mother being wife, an individual who is enemy being friend and being vice versa is found. Thus in the samsara, there is not much certainty. The traversing of many relatives, enemies and friends doesn't come only in successive births, but even in this life, it is evident that one who is extremely close in the upper part of life becomes enemy in the latter part of life. And someone who is ready to kill each other in the previous year becomes a dearest friend in the following year. Thus, there is no reliable certainty in friend and enemy, and hence reflect on the suffering of indefiniteness. As stated in the past, on the terms of the perfect divine nectars that we drank, and in between the human breast milk that we suck, and finally the unclean liquids and the molten iron that we drank will be greater and much more than countless great oceans, and even that did not satisfy. Thus, I reflect on the lack of satisfaction in the desirous enjoyment, just like the example of the laborer seeking comfort from fire. Numberlessness of lives. Thus, leave aside other physical abandonment due to various diseases. Even if we were to put together the heads that have been cut by weapons, it will become higher than the Brahma world. Thus, think that still, if you do not get free from cycling of existence, things will not go beyond the observed reality of having to give up one's body again and again. That's in order to count our main mother and her mother and also her mother. Even if this great earth is turned into small pills and counted, it will not be countable, which is directly denoted by the power of the word and limit. And what is implied is one will not be able to count even one's mother. So till here is thinking about the suffering of the intermediate persons. The next is intermediary verses. Amidst turbid and unclean substances of the womb, do not see the sight of form as object. And in the dark pit, one is crushed with intense and total suffering. The state of body flourishing with beauty and glamour, the hair with the color of eye medicine becomes white like snow. The one with radiant complexion is black like darkness. The body standing straight becomes bent like a bow. Craving to desirous object vanishes, and one is overpowered by aging. So, the second outline is contemplating about the origin, the stages of the entrance of cyclic existence. Having known the state of suffering of existence, as just been explained, and if you do not dislike it, its cause has to be abandoned. To abandon that, the cause must be identified. What is it? It is the origin. There are two in this action, an afflicted emotion, and the main is afflicted emotion. For example, it is like a dry field where even if you plant seed, if it did not come into contact with water, manure and so on, it will not produce fruit, as Pramanavartika states. States an action of a person who has thoroughly crossed, transcended the craving of existence, it is not possible to project other lives, as the cooperative factor has been seized. Thus, a person who has accumulated an action to be born in an animal, if it attains the state of peace before encountering that action, then that action ceases without producing fruit. Hence, the Bodhicharya Avatara states, even in the case the gods and demigods all rise against me as enemies, even they do not have the power to take and put me in the fire of hell without respite. And when met with this powerful enemy of afflicted emotions, I will be thrown into it within one moment. As stated, even if the entire sentient beings rise as enemies, they will be unable to put to suffering in the future lives. But when this enemy of afflicted emotions encounters the conditions, there is no way but to be tormented by instant suffering and destroyed to dust. If this afflicted emotion is to be identified, when attachment, hatred and so forth develops, the mind becomes unclear, and this is called lack of unpeaceful. So it has to be identified on the basis of such a consciousness that makes the continuum of your mind totally disturbed. The presence of afflicted emotions in a latent state within our mind is difficult to separate like a paper set by oil. A person with chronic illness appears physically well, but after taking a food that activates the illness, the pain develops. Likewise, when we see attractive boys and girls, horses and animals, sick clothes and precious stones, it nourishes it, and the attachment that was in the dormant form arises in the manifest form and develops an automatic and impulsive desire to see, touch and enjoy them. For example, if a person by the name Devadatta is to be killed, then his facial shape and so forth should be ascertained without mixing with others, and later on, whenever it comes, the weapon should be used. Thus, when the spiritual master Bengonge said, at the entrance of afflicted emotions, hold the short spear of antidote, also seemed to mean this. When you see an enemy or someone you dislike, then with harsh, harmful mind, you think, by what means should I harm? And an intense hatred, like a coal fire ignited, red by wind, that afflicted emotion is anger. Due to self-grasping, on the basis of higher lineage caste, richness of wealth, qualities, knowledge of hearing, and physical etc. skill, and you think that such and such persons, individual, cannot compete, even a poor of my body, and this afflicted emotion, that is aspect of being pulled up with the grasping of oneself, as supreme is pride. In a house without window, even if there are many articles with different colors and shapes, but due to darkness, one will not know them as black or white, or good or bad, or so forth. Likewise, the afflicted emotion that obscures and makes unclear all modes of existence of suchness and varied things, like the modes of existence, of action and result, four truths, so forth, is ignorance. The afflicted emotion that doubts whether these things, like the three jewels, action and result, and so forth, which are taught from the scripture, are true or not, and which hinders developing a sentiment or conviction to the object, is doubt. The afflicted wisdom that grabs as I and my on the basis, like the five aggregates, as the basis of designation, which disintegrates in the second moment of its time, due to being impermanent and which is not one, but many, is the way of transitory collection. The nihilistic afflicted wisdom that sees this grasping of I on the basis of aggregate as not permanent and everlasting, or conjoining the womb from this to the future, is way of grasping the extreme. The afflicted wisdom which grabs superiority by focusing on any of the three, way of the transitory, way of extreme, and wrong view or aggregate independence on which they are produced, is way of grasping superiority. The afflicted wisdom that aspires achieving liberation by observing disciplines like abandoned and corrupted morality from one's viewpoint, cutting hair and keeping human skins and skeletons, stopping food, using the five fires and gazing at the sun while standing on one leg, remaining naked and anointing ashes on the body and not speaking, and observing the aggregate independence they are produced, grasping ethical discipline and conduct as supreme. Here it is not the pride of grasping of superiority towards a genuine ethical discipline, but it is taught that it has to be a wrong view.
Nyamogwa
For example, the darkness which makes the way of the existence of a coil unclear is ignorance, and due to that, the grasping that perceives the robe is like the way of the transcendental collection, and it is these two which access root of all afflicted emotions, and due to attachment and hatred, all faults are produced. So here it's clear that the basis of anger is also attachment and desire. So from desire, the anger also arises, and also all the other afflicted emotions. And this is really very well said here. Even if it is accepted that the afflicted emotions, the cause of generation of all faults, is slightly suppressed, if you are unable to avoid them, then like a reflection that appears in the mirror, the dormant will act as the basis for the progression of the afflicted emotions. Just as when a mirror and form meets immediately, the reflection appears in relation to various objects like enemy, friends and so forth. Through the development of manifest objects, the afflicted emotion increased, and one will be distanced from spiritual guides and Dharma friends, and due to the activities of words and behaviors of bad friends with extremely great afflicted emotions and so on, the afflicted emotions increase. The afflicted emotions increase due to claiming of non-virtuous guides and so forth, who while having not attained liberation, see they have attained it. The afflicted emotions also increase due to strong familiarity and habituation in the past, just like a person who is thoroughly trained in his prayer can verbally continue uninterruptedly even when his mind is let loose. Thinking that this person has benefited me or harmed me, in this way, various exaggerations are made out of hatred and attachment. Thinking that this person has committed great negative deeds but still living happily, thus action and the results are untrue. So, through improper mental engagement, afflicted emotions are increased. Hence, I identify these six causes, and unless you are able to develop a practice which is similar to ambushing the enemy at the narrow bypass, and if you are all powered by afflicted emotions, then one will develop varied negative deeds here and after, and one will be put to sufferings of the cyclic existence and distance from transcendence of suffering. Earlier, because of treating this as friend, I have gone to the root of all downfalls. Even for having done minor harms in this life, you react with much disliking, calling that person as your enemy. Then why don't you act effectively towards this enemy of afflicted emotions that had put you in only suffering from beginningless lives until now? By repeatedly applying the antidote that destroyed this, if you uproot it, it will not be able to repeat like other enemies. So the term Sanskrit term kalisha or afflicted emotions suffers, it represents or it means to be to make one's mental continuum or makes oneself uncomfortable and bring disturbance to one's the current stable form of mind. The ordinary enemy, if banished from the land, will live in other place, and after thoroughly capturing it, will empower themselves and will then return. The way of the afflicted emotion is not like that. The afflicted emotions are eliminated by the wisdom eye, Where will it go once removed from the mind? Where will it live and return to harm me? It is just that I, with weak mind, lack effort. Thus, those that have taken birth due to action and afflicted emotions are not beyond death and conception, the womb. It may be a timely death due to exhaustion of life or due to one of the nine factors of sudden death, like wrong food and behavior and so forth, as is taught in the sutra. Thus, there are many types. However, at the time of death and after death, that which helps and harms is the accumulation of virtue and non-virtue by the two, mental action and the intended action, due to which happiness and sufferings arise. As such, it is possible that someone performing prayerful virtue in this life gets his power and life harmed and develops great suffering at the time of death, and likewise there are those who engaging excessively in negative deeds and experiencing perfect well-being. Thus, there are some fools who develop the misconception and say action and results are untrue as is this. How can we be certain that these are not the results of powerful virtues and non-virtues of previous life ripening in this life? On the other hand, as the Bodhicharya Avatara states, isn't it good if a person to be executed is freed by cutting his hand? Isn't it good if one is without help by the human suffering? As stated, justice is a fault, for execution is freed by cutting the hand. Someone who is to be born in the hell in the future is suffice by experiences of suffering in the life of a human being. It could be known from things like King Tsukhuiche, due to having thrown powder to Arya Kadiana, although in the beginning there was rainfall of precious jewel stones and so forth, but later was crushed under the rainfall of earth. Particularly, whether one will be immediately born in happy migration or bad migration is stated in Abhidharma. The action in the samsara, by whichever is heavier, whichever is closer, and whichever more is more habituated. And whichever one has done first, out of which the first one will mature first. Thus, with whichever one is more familiar will be remembered automatically. In the case of some who are unclear due to illness, it can be nourished by friends through various words of virtue. For example, even in the case of a person whose negative deed is equal in terms of heaviness and lightness, and there is no closeness or distantness of the result, at the case of a person engaging in great negative deeds, if at the time of death he dies with a manifest virtuous state of mind, he will be born in happy migration. Even if one has accumulated powerful virtues, if at the time of death he develops negative minds, he will be born in bad migration. Thus, I see one crucial point here. However, since one's own mind is not hidden to oneself, and since happiness and regret develops by recollecting actions done in the past, even in the case of a person who is not aware of the distinction of the positive and negative, there is no other way but to encounter the negative mind with which one is familiar in this life. However, through the names of Tathagata and special mantras, one will be stopped from bad states of migration, and thus they also have great merits. At the time of subtle death, neither virtuous nor non-virtuous appearance will develop, and thus it is a neutral mind. So from all this explanation, it's very evident that the afflicted emotions harm us in a great way. And also when we look at the among the human beings, also even among the different animals, the reason behind why they fight with each other, it is the only reason is due to one's own afflicted emotions. So even the great sins that are listed in Christianity, cardinal sins, as of course all these arises from the afflicted emotions, and we have to see the negative side of afflicted emotions. So since when a religion is based on compassion and love, and of course the greatest enemy that is to be defeated is the desire and the anger. But the one which really focus and try to identify the nature of the afflicted emotion, then it is only the traditions that we find in India. And only in the Indian traditions, there is a custom of practicing the Kamai Biting meditation and spiritual insight. And having renounce and having shown the antidote to the evident form of the afflicted emotions, there are many cases where the practitioners gain a certain kind of liberation, a kind of a temporary liberation from the evident afflicted emotions. So the next is intermittent verses. So here, when we speak about practicing the three trainings, of course, the general three trainings and the higher three trainings, we have to make a differentiate that the higher three training is more important here. And by repeatedly relying on this friend of afflicted emotions, from beginningless time and without suffering from one's mind, even for a moment, one is thrown into the invisible end of the ocean of samsara. So the next is thinking about the negative sides of the samsaric places through thinking about the 12 interdependent links. So thinking about the suffering nature through the 12 interdependent links. So the causes of the dependent, the causes that bring us to the samsaric existence is the interdependent link of the craving and desire, from which comes the existence. So the order of the three interdependent links, first it starts from the interdependent link of the ignorance, and here the interdependent link of ignorance is the cause of, is the primary cause that bring us all to the suffering. and that generates that also, that is the reason why all the other afflicted emotions are also generated. And generally we categorize the ignorance into two, the ignorance pertaining to the cause and effect, and ignorance pertaining to the ultimate reality. Then through the ignorance, we tend to make karmas, intelligent negative actions, and through that we accumulate negative karmas to be reborn in the lower realms, or even the positive karmas that we are to be reborn in the higher rebirths as human being. So in one cycle of the two interdependent links, the first, the cycle can be divided, and the first categorization can be termed as the cause of the rebirths, which the dual interdependent link of ignorance comes as the first. Then the result, once we take rebirth, then starting from mother's womb, starting from development of the five organs, and so on. And here the sacred words of Manjushri, the transmission is something that is being given through the experience of the spiritual master. And of course the spiritual master will be someone who has the real experience through his own practice. So even though he may not have such kind of complete practice, but whatever the rough or the coarse practices that he have, he will give teachings based on it. And before, there are also traditions that there are no texts to be read or to be seen. So, but whatever the visualizations or the practice that the masters have, he give the teaching for a session. And after giving some difficult points of the text, difficult points explaining, then later, so he also, later the spiritual master also gives the teaching in a condensed form, first in a very extensive form, then later for the purpose of easily meditating and understanding and contemplating upon it, so he presents it in a very condensed manner. There was Rinpoche lying near the Nepal border, and when he gave the transmission to me, he was telling me that of course it will be benefit to give the transmission in this way. So even though I'm not sure whether he has a very extensive learning about the great text, but the way he gave the transmission is really remarkable. So the human rebirth and the human precious body that we have is actually the result of our previous karma, and the karma and one of the causes, conditions that which actualize this human body is the interdependent link of the craving and the desire. So therefore, one is to understand that since the interdependent link of ignorance, which is the ultimate, which is also termed as the origin, is the main factor behind why we are at such a present state. So therefore, we have to work hard in order to eradicate that ignorance. So second, how to practice in order to liberate from the samsara. So it is stated that the only measure that we have to take in order to be liberated from this cyclic existence is the practicing of the three trainings. And even for such trainings, the first, it is very important that we have a very stable mind, a mind who has a mind which has the potential to concentrate on its focus. Having such a mind, then through the concentration, gradually it will be able to fight or it will be able to influence the arising afflicted emotions within us, and through that it will become a cause for further attainment of the higher rebirths. And the training of the wisdom is also very important here, as the wisdom is the actual process or is the actual antidote that eradicates the root of the ignorance and which brings us directly to the resultant liberation. So therefore, for the beginners and as a foundation, it is very important to have a very concentrated mind. So therefore, we have to practice in order to generate the karma abiding meditations. So that is the primary reason why the author of the Four Noble Truths is also first having the truth of suffering, then the origin of the suffering. So in terms of the origin, of course, the truth of origin of the suffering comes first. While Lord Buddha gives the teaching, as Maitreya has stated, that first the truth of suffering is emphasized and given at the first of the order. And in order to for a practitioner to practice the paths of the great being, including the compassion and the great bodhicitta, it is very important that one has the practices of the middle intermediate, the middling person and the smaller person as the foundations. So without having the foundation understanding of the other two paths, two lower paths, there is no possibility that we could move forward to the practice of the Mahayana. And so from the three trainings, the training in ethical discipline is praised as the foundation of the other two trainings. And as it is stated also in the Vinaya Sutras and all the Vinaya texts, that without having practice of ethical discipline as the base, it is impossible to generate or develop further realizations within us. So the foundation of ethical discipline is something that can be compared to the ground or the earth on which, with having the conditions of the rain and the sunlight, there is a possibility for the crops and the flowers and the trees to grow. So similarly, in order to have higher realizations of higher realizations of wisdoms, one need to have a foundation of ethical discipline. So till here is completed the path shared by the middling person. Here the author says that whatever he has composed here is all due to the kindness of the Lama Tsongkhapa himself. And the path and the teachings being presented here is something which we can all presented, which we can all practice in a very convenient manner. So this is also the means and a way to engage in the ocean of the omniscient land. So the next is the Southern Lineage Lamrim. We are on page number 219. Training the mind on the stages of the path, shared with intermediate beings. The lamp for the path says, with the will to turn from samsara's pleasures, whose nature is the rejection of sin, whoever is concerned with personal peace alone is a being known as intermediate. This section has two parts, contemplating the suffering of samsara, explaining the stages of practice of the path, granting liberation from them. The first one, this is two parts, suffering and its origins. The first one in the sutra, it says, O bhikkhus, this is the arya truth of suffering. This is the arya truth of its origins. We are in page number 220 of the Southern Lineage Lamrim. So I'm reading the new and revised edition of the Pearl Garland. So if you happen to have the new and the revised edition, you can turn to page number 220. Announcing the resultant truth of suffering, first in the causal truth of its origins, subsequently may seem like a reversal of cause and effect. However, Lord Buddha had a specific purpose in mind in doing so, regarding which the 400 verses says, if the ocean of samsara has absolutely no limit, O child, who are plunged in it, why are you not frightened? In the Uttara Tantra says, just as an illness is to be diagnosed and the illness cause is rejected, health is to be gained and treatment to be followed, so are suffering its causes, cessation, and likewise the path to be identified, rejected, gained, and followed. Having recognized that happiness and suffering are both results, it is extremely important to accomplish and abandon the causes that produce them. Consequently, the actual topic of contemplation refers mainly to the suffering of higher realms. Its meditation topics are threefold. Human sufferings are those of the other two kinds of higher rebirths. In addition, those shared by all six categories of life. First, regarding human suffering, although Lord Buddha taught four types of rebirth, mainly birth from a womb will be discussed. You are below the stomach, above the intestines, facing the spine, floating in an unclean and smelly slime. As you progress from the curing stage to the point when your limbs are formed, whenever your mother eats hot food or liquids, you feel as though you are being thrust into a fire. When she takes them cold, you have the impression of being encased in ice. When she jumps, runs, and so forth, you sense that you are falling down a cliff and the like. Your mother's various kinds of careless behavior induce great suffering. When 266 days have gone by, the karmic wind makes your head turn downward. When you move out through the very narrow pelvic bones, you suffer as if your flesh and skin were being torn. Furthermore, although after delivery you are placed on a soft bed, you suffer as though you are being thrust into a thorn bush. When the amniotic fluid is wiped, you suffer as if you are being skinned alive. When the umbilical cord is cut, you suffer as if you are being butchered. When your mother takes you into her lap, you suffer as a fledgling being carried off by a hawk does. In page number 221, when wrapped in cloth and placed in a cradle, you suffer as though you are being bound, imprisoned, and the like. Thus contemplate how the suffering are difficult to bear. for the suffering of aging, thing my hair has gone white, my body stoops, and my forehead is covered in wrinkles. Given the way my body has weakened, although I have yet to change bodies, I may as well have. Young practitioners should consider someone who is old and feeble and thing. I will not escape the same suffering of aging. So the next is the suffering of illness, then after that is the suffering of dying. I'm turning to page number 222. The suffering of gods and demigods. Although gods of the desire realm do not undergo the sufferings of birth, aging, etc., as humans do when their death is imminent. Certainly, their complexion fades, they no longer want to remain on their comfortable seats, their flower garlands wilt, their clothes take on an unpleasant odor, and they perspire. Which previously they had never done. These are five signs of death. The radiance of their body also fades. The water of their ablution sticks their body. Their clothing and ornaments emit unpleasant sounds. Their eyes blink. They feel attachment for specific objects. These are the signs of impending death. Conscious that the ten augur their death, they are miserable. In particular, when those called three events investigate the matter, they become aware in advance where they will be born next. Knowing, for example, that they should be reborn in hell, they experience unbearable torment, exactly as if they were already there. Humans can only surmise that they will be reborn in hell. They lack such absolute certainty. For the gods, it is different, which is why their suffering is said to be far greater. The gods experience other torments as well. When those of lesser merit see gods of greater merit, they feel intimidated. The weaker are banished by the more powerful. When doing battle with the demigods, they kill and are killed, their bodies and limbs being chopped and cut to pieces. The gods of the form and formless realm do not undergo the above manifest sufferings. However, just as a ship's pigeon returns to its vessel once the propelling karma of their samadhi is exhausted, after that they are obliged to experience the manifest suffering of the desire realm. Reflect upon this well. The third outline for the attendant topic, the sufferings common to all six categories of life. There is potential suffering as long as you are not free of samsara. Although by the power of your merit, you may become a well-wilting monarch or Brahma, you will again become a slave. Then there are present sufferings, those of birth, aging, illness, and death in the present life. There is manifest suffering, suffering that is aggravated by contact with the transforming tactile phenomenon like salt water poured into an open wound. There is a suffering of change. When tired from walking, if you rest, you have an impression of well-being, but after some time, your legs and back hurt. All pervasive suffering is similar to the experience of a person encased in ice. As long as he is not extracted from heat, he can never feel warm. To summarize the significance of the above, once you have taken rebirth with impure, appropriated aggregates, you cannot help but experience suffering on the basis of your present aggregates, which also necessarily induce further future sufferings. I'm turning to page number 224. Meditating on the origins, the process of entering samsara. Once you have understood the condition of samsaric and cyclic suffering just explained, if you do not want it, you must reject its causes. To reject its causes, you must identify them as karma and kleshas, and the principle being the kleshas. For example, like seeds planted in dry earth, which fail to bear fruit unless they encounter water, fertilizer, from humidity and so forth. The Pramanavartika says, by overcoming the karma of samsaric craving, other karmas, aptitude for pollution is lost, for the contributing cause is exhausted. If someone who has accumulated karma for an animal rebirth attains peace before having to face that karma, the karma in question becomes null and void and does not bear fruit. Once you have identified the disturbing mental factors, understand that those that exist as latent potentialities in your mind stream are as difficult to expel as all stains from paper. Like people with latent illnesses who appear as healthy but have pain when their illness is provoked by incorrect diet, the fact of seeing attractive things, young men and women, horses, livestock, clothing, silks, precious metals and stones and so on, stimulates latent attachment and make it manifest. Attachment is the disturbing mental factor that is a strong wish to enjoy this, in other words, to gaze upon them, touch them and so on. Upon seeing an enemy or someone, when you feel intense hostility and ask yourself what you can do to harm them, that is anger, the clash of fierce animosity that blazes like an emperor kindled by the wind. When through the influence of self-grasping and based on high birth, wealth, good education, physical dexterity and so on, you think these people do not compare with even a single pore of my body, it is pride. The klesha that is an aspect of conceit and of considering yourself superior. Just as in a windowless house containing a large number of items of varying colors and shapes, because of the darkness, you cannot distinguish white from black, good from bad, and so on. The klesha that renders obscure and unclear all that exists at both relative and ultimate levels is ignorance. Doubt is the klesha that makes you question the truthfulness of what is explained in scripture regarding the three jewels and so on, and prevents you from gaining certainty of the phenomenon in question. Founded on a basis of imputation, such as the five aggregates, which are impermanent and disintegrate the moment following the present instant, and are not unitary but multiple collections, the view of transitory collection is a disturbed wisdom that apprehend at it as the self, calling it I and mine. Extreme views of the disturbed wisdoms that view the aggregates apprehended to be I as either permanent, immobile or subject to annihilation, implying no future conception after this life. We're on page number 226, the second outline, contemplating in relation to the 12 links of interdependence. The Rise Seedling Sutra says, what is dependent arising? What is called dependent arising is this: because this exists, that occurs. Because this has arisen, this arises. In other words, the compositional factor is conditioned by ignorance. Consciousness is conditioned by the compositional factor. Due to the condition that is birth, aging and death, misery, lamentation, suffering, distress and trouble might occur. This is how a great mass of pure suffering arises. On the other hand, when ignorance ceases, the compositional factor ceases. When birth ceases, aging and death cease, and the misery, lamentation, suffering, distress, and a troubled mind cease. This is how a great mass of pure suffering exists. Where page number 227, the second outline, the stages of practice of the path granting liberation from the above. By training in the ethical discipline, which turns a distracted mind into one free of distraction, manifest glaciers are halted. By training in concentration, which turns an unabsorbed mind into one that is absorbed, the manifestation of glacier is prevented. Training in wisdom, which turns an unfree mind into one that is free, eradicates the kleshas. As a result, nirvana is achieved. This pure ethical discipline is the very root of all short and long-term happiness and goodness. It is explained in the King of Concentrations Sutra that its benefits are immense, especially in this age when the five kinds of degeneration are on the rise.
Teaching
So where the inter-chapter beings who aspire to liberation and enlightenment reflect on samsaric suffering and to seek liberation from samsara, engage in the three trainings and strive in the Mahayana bodhicitta and pure view. So we will stop here today.